Dr. K. S. Ramakrishnan is working as an assistant professor, School of Education, Tamil Nadu Open University, Chennai 15. He has been teaching science education, environmental science, educational technology and research methodology in various colleges of education and Tamil Nadu Open University for the past 9 years. He has guided so many M.Ed., M.Phil and Ph.D. students. His current research areas are environmental education, educational technology and media and communication. He has conducted various workshops on ICT usage in education, Wiki Educator, e-content development and educational research methodology. He had attended many online workshops on Moodle, learning analytics. He has published 6 books and many articles in national and international journals of repute. He regularly gives plenary and keynote speeches on environment and ICT related issues at various national and international conferences. He has delivered 28 episodes of the program Pudiyodor Ulagam at All India Radio, Chennai, related to various new developments in science and technology.
Welcome to UGC CEC program. In this episode of Environmental Science, we are going to discuss the forest and wildlife management in India. See the content: the types of forest and forest coverage, the issues of sustainable management of forest, the main issues of forest management, some important forest in North, East, West and South India, and some steps for better forest management. See, now let us classify the wildlife. See, the wildlife can be classified into farms, forest, wetlands, stream, lakes and ponds. So, in that way that we can classify the wildlife, and today that we are going to discuss only the forest management. And there are many kinds of forest, and out of that the reserved forest and the protected forest, these are the major two important classification of forest. And the type of forest is declared by the state governments according to nature and the extent of human activities permitted. So, these are decided upon to what extent that we may permit the human beings to execute or to do activities. See, for example, the reserved forest, and here the rights to hunting, grazing, etc. are banned unless specific orders. So, it is not like that every time that they are totally banned, but in case if the condition deems, they may be permitted. So, these are called the reserve forest. And then comes the protected forest. On the other hand, the rights to hunting, grazing, etc. are allowed unless specific orders. So, in the first one, they are not allowed unless specific orders. And in the second one, they are allowed unless specific orders, and therefore, most of the forest they are coming in either one of the categories. And now, how to upgrade the forest? See, first the reserved forest, they are upgraded to the wildlife sanctuaries, and again they are upgraded to national park, and each category receive higher degree of protection and government funding. And therefore, starting from the reserved forest, and they can be elevated up to the national park, and therefore, these are the upgradation of the forest. And now, let us discuss about the forest coverage in India. See, in total, there is a network of around 668 protected areas or PAs, and 1,61,221 square kilometer area, and 4.90% of total geographic area is covered by the forest, and there are 515 wildlife sanctuaries and 102 national parks and 47 conservation reserves and 4 community reserves, and therefore, this is the total forest coverage in India. And as far as Indian forestry is concerned, there are 3500 species of mammals and 30,000 kinds of insect and 15,000 varieties of plants, and so these are all the forest coverage in India. Now let us see what are the main issues of the sustainable forest management, because the forest management has to be sustainable, because there are economic activities, ecological activities, biological activities, and therefore there is an interrelation between the ecology, environment, biology and sociology and economy also, and therefore we have to consider all these factors when we are taking into the forest conservation. And therefore, now what are the major issues in the management of forest? First of all, legality. See, the forest owner or manager, that means the government, because in the former times the forest were managed by the kings or the lords, but now everything is taken over by the government, and therefore the forest owner or the manager holds a legal right to harvest, process and trade the forest products in compliance with the relevant international, national and regional laws. And therefore, it is the first and foremost condition that they have to abide by the legal procedures or the legalities. And the second one, that is the environmental sustainability, the forest managed in a way which preserves health of the forest for future generation, because environmental sustainability has to be preserved, and therefore that is the second point. And the third one, that is the social sustainability, and the forest products harvested, processed and traded with respect to the rights and working conditions of those directly affected. And therefore, these are the three conditions on which the forest management depends upon: the legality and the social sustainability and the environmental sustainability. And therefore, these are all the three factors. Now let us discuss one by one. And for ensuring the sustainability, first let us discuss the ecological aspect. The maintenance and appropriate enhancement of forest resources and their contribution to global carbon cycle, because the carbon cycle or the carbon count, that is one of the major issue nowadays, because nowadays that we are using a lot of carbon dioxide emission, and therefore in totality how much carbon dioxide or carbon is emitted, that's called the carbon count. And therefore the maintenance should be in accordance with the global carbon cycles. It should not affect the global carbon cycles. And the maintenance of forest ecosystem health and vitality, because the health of the forest has to be conserved, and the forest should be vital also. And the third ecological aspect, the maintenance, conservation and appropriate enhancement of biological diversity in forest ecosystems. And already in the previous episode we have seen the biological diversity or biodiversity, that means the number of animals, species which are existing in a particular ecosystem, that's called the biodiversity. And therefore it depends upon various factor, and that has to be sustained, because sometimes what happen, one particular gene or one particular species may be large in number at the cost of the other varieties, and that should not happen. And therefore the biodiversity in forest ecosystem, that must be conserved. And another point, that is the maintenance and appropriate enhancement of protective functions of forest management, because the forest are protecting so many ecological variables, for example temperature, water, all these are protected by the forest environment, and therefore the protective functions should not be disturbed at any cost. Because for example, if we are involving in deforestation, what will happen, it is increasing the temperature, and that in turn will decrease the moisture and the water flow, and therefore the protective function of the ecosystem, even though the ecosystem may be hale and sustainable, then also the protective function of the ecosystem, that is disturbed, and that shouldn't happen. And now the economic aspect, the maintenance and encouragement of productive functions of forest, for example the wood and non-wood, because mostly the forest are utilized for their wood product, and therefore the economic factors should be taken into account. and the social account or the social aspect, the maintenance of other socio-economic functions and conditions. Because the forest ecosystem that is deeply interwoven with the society or the people who are living there, and therefore the social functions also should be taken into account. See, some measures have been already taken for the forest conservation, and one such measure that is the global area certification. And you look at the numbers, in May 2012, the global area of certified forest, that is 394 million hectare, because the governments, various governments or various private agencies, they have started certifying the forest according to their nature and according to their health. And therefore, out of the certification of various agencies, in total 394 million hectares of forests were certified. And that is a 4% increase, that is 14.8 million hectares since May 2011. So it's a good symbol, because in a year 4% increase in the forest certification, that's really a good impact. That means the people have become more aware of the destructions happened to the forest. And the world's certified forest area is approaching around some 10%. That means it is gradually increasing. That let us see in the forthcoming diagram. See, look at the diagram, and it is starting from 2005 to May 2012, and these are all various agencies: FSC, PEFC, SFI, ATFS. All these are various agencies, and therefore they are represented in the bar diagram. And therefore in 2005 it was around some 250 million hectares, and gradually that it is increasing, and the growth rate may be somewhat less or more, but anyhow there is definitely an increase. And in May 2012 it is around some 400 million hectares. That means this much amount of forest area has been certified by all these global agencies, and therefore before that they were not certified, but now they have been started certifying, and that is what is represented in this diagram. Now, what are the conservation efforts which have been taken? See, the forest cover has to be increased, and the scrub cover to maintain the healthy soil, and sustainable development, limited amount of resources to sustain the limited people, because there should be sustainability, because the resources are limited, and therefore they can be available to limited people only, and therefore we have to maintain the sustainability and the growing of trees, and more dustbins in all public places, because the problem is that all the dust or various wastages which are happening, which are emitted in the city areas, they are dumped into the forest region, and therefore by putting more dustbins in all public places, that may be a good effort in conservation of the forest and encouraging a cleaner environment. So these are all some conservation effort that has been taken by various governments so far. And first point is preserving the biodiversity, diversity of genes. Suppose even though in a particular variety there are so many sub varieties, for example dog, there are Alsatians, Doberman and greyhound, puppies, and like that there are so many varieties, all are dog, but there are so many varieties, and this is called the diversity of gene. In a particular species, number of varieties, so that has to be conserved. And second, the diversity of number of species. For example, if you take the animal kingdom, that is a dog, cat, rat, all these are various species, and therefore that diversity should be preserved. And the third one, the variety of ecosystem, because in a particular area there are so many ecosystems are there, the forest, marine and soil, like that there are mountain, like that there are so many ecosystems are there, and that also is causing a biodiversity, because if more number of ecosystems are prevailing in a particular place, that means there are more number of species they can survive there, and therefore all the three factors has to be preserved for conservation of the forest. And therefore, the first point is we have to preserve the biodiversity. See, there are many types of wildlife relationships are there, because in biodiversity there are so many animals or plants, and there are the relationship between the animal species, and that is either parasite, that means one may be living on the other but without killing it, that is called the parasite, and mutual, that means X and Y, X is helping Y and Y is helping X. And predation means it is also depending upon the other, but by killing the other species, and that is called the predator. For example, the rat is killed by cat, and therefore the cat is a predator for rat. And then commensalism and competition, and these are other two varieties, and therefore in these various ways the relationship between the wildlife that is maintained, and therefore we have to take care of all this, the relationship between the various animal species. Let us have a short break. Welcome back. Let us proceed. Now, what are the various threats for biodiversity? The habitat destruction, pollution, and the species introduction. Suppose if you are introducing a new species into an existing forest ecosystem, then that is also polluting the entire area, because the new species may not be able to adjust with the existing species, and therefore the species introduction and the global climate change and exploitation, all these are some of the factors which are threatening the biodiversity. And deforestation, already we have seen, the population explosion, fires, pests, and the grazing and gnawing of mammals, weather and dams, and zooming, that is shifting the cultivation, because constantly shifting the cultivation from one place to another place, or at a particular place also from one variety to another variety, all these are some varieties of the deforestation, and therefore all these are also other facts which is affecting the forest ecosystem, and therefore they have to be controlled. And already we have seen the forest loss in Asia is directly proportional to the human population, and therefore as the population density that is increasing, the forest area that is constantly decreasing, and therefore it is a definite that the population is affecting the forest, and therefore the population should be controlled at any cost. And the fire management, because the fire is one of the major cause for the forest ecosystem damage, and therefore the fire that has to be controlled. And there are so many reasons, because by natural temperature gradient also the fire may cause, but anyhow the fire has to be controlled or managed. And so the firefighting is a high priority for forest managers, and many plant communities are fire adapted, and accumulation of the woody debris, and 40% of all forest lands are at risk of severe fires, and therefore the fire management is one factor for the forest management. And the firefighting costs are very heavy, and therefore natural ways we have to try to control the fire. And this is a world map which is depicting the human disturbance among the forest, and wherever the green areas are there, they are predominantly natural, and yellow they are partially disturbed, and red they are human dominated. And therefore in most part of the Asia the forests are human dominated, and in many parts of North America, South America, and Russia and Africa, and they are predominantly natural, and many parts of Australia also. And so this diagram is telling which parts are controlled by, predominantly controlled by the human being. As far as India is concerned, most parts of the Indian forest they are human dominated. And now let us discuss about what are the various wildlife in various parts of the country. And first, the wildlife in North India. The North India is predominantly the Himalayas and Gangetic plains, which are very fertile, and the favorable climate conditions and topographical diversity is supporting the rich mix of flora and fauna, and it provides shelter to finest and rarest wildlife and wildlife sanctuaries. And the Corbett National Park, Ranthambore National Park and Bharatpur National Park, these are all some examples which are existing in the northern India, and these are all some various types of animals existing in the North India. And the Jim Corbett Park, and what are the animals? Leopards, jungle cat, deer, sloth, the Himalayan black bears, Indian grey mongoose, otters, Indian pangolins, langur, rhesus monkeys, owls and nightjars. So all these are some varieties of animals which are existing in the Jim Corbett National Park. It is in Uttaranchal. And second, Keoladeo Gana National Park, that is in Rajasthan. And the list of animal: the blue bull, Nilgai, feral cattle, the spotted deer, the wild boar, mongoose, jackals and hyenas. Hyena is a particular small animal, and they are existing in the Gana National Park in Rajasthan. Now, the Ranthambore National Park, it is also in Rajasthan. The tigers and striped hyenas, sambar deer, chital, nilgai, macaques, jackals, jungle cats, caracals, sloth bears, black bucks and rufous tailed hare, Indian wild boar and chinkara. And particularly the nilgai, chinkara and the sambar deer, they are very popular in the Ranthambore National Park, Rajasthan. In Madhya Pradesh, the Bandhavgarh National Park, Madhya Pradesh, and again there is a good population of the wild tigers, leopards, deer, white tiger, and which is very less in number, and it is one of the endangered species, and gaur, that is the Indian bison, sambar, Indian wolf and nilgai, all these are some speciality in the Bandhavgarh National Park in Madhya Pradesh. Kanha National Park, it's very popular and it is very large also, and there the Royal Bengal tigers, Bengal tiger is a special variety of the tigers, leopards, the sloth bear, barasingha, Indian wild dog, python, python is a variety of snake, cobras and crate. All these are the variety of animals which you can see in the Kanha National Park. It is one of the very well maintained national park also in the northern hemisphere. Now, in the East India, it's very unique and diverse. Eastern region, that means the Orissa and Bengal, and that is home to a number of endangered species, very different from the rest of India. And the Sundarbans, West Bengal and Kaziranga Wildlife Sanctuary, Assam, they are some example. See, in the Sundarban area, it is mostly, that is a water is there, that is a marshy land, and therefore that ecosystem, that is forest as well as the marsh ecosystem, and therefore it is very peculiar and unique, and it is very diverse also, and it is a home for some endangered species. And particularly the Kaziranga Wildlife Sanctuary, it is very popular for its animals. And first let us see the Sundarban animal: tigers, leopards, rhinoceros, wild buffaloes, wild hawks, wild cat, barasingha, spotted deer, hawk deer, barking deer and monkeys. And particularly that it is having a good number of tigers also, that's why it is called the Bengal tigers, and therefore the Sundarban, West Bengal, and that is recently announced as a UNESCO World Heritage also. And crocodiles also, they are very popular there. and the Kaziranga National Park, Assam, and it is very popular, internationally popular for the rhinoceros and the one-horned rhinoceros, the wild Asiatic water buffalo, Indian munchak, wild boar, hog deer, tigers, leopards, rock python, king cobra, and a variety of birds. That's the popularity of the Kaziranga National Park, Assam. And now, let us discuss about the southern region. In South India, what are the popular national park? It is extraordinarily green, lush area, unusual and varied flora and fauna. In comparison with the northern region, the southern region is very extraordinary and it is very unusual also. And therefore, you look, there are 500 mammal species, 1225 varieties of birds and 1600 types of reptiles, and therefore, there is a rich variety of birds and animals existing in the southern region. And the Periyar Wildlife Sanctuary, Kerala, Bandipur Wildlife Sanctuary, Karnataka, and Dandeli Wildlife Sanctuary, Karnataka, and they are some popular national parks in the southern region. And now, let us discuss one by one. The Periyar Wildlife Sanctuary, it's in Kerala, and it is a very lush green ecosystem. Tigers, the Indian elephants, barking deer, mouse deer, it is a particular variety, dholes, gaur, sambar mongoose, foxes, leopards, and the thar. And therefore, these are all some varieties, and particularly the Periyar Wildlife Sanctuary, it is very popular for the elephants, that is the Indian elephants. And the next is the Bandipur Sanctuary in Karnataka, and again elephants, tigers, bears, muggers, rock pythons, and four horned antelopes and dholes. So, they are all, see, look at, they are the four horned antelope, that is a kind of deer population, and therefore, these are all the biodiversity in the Bandipur Wildlife Sanctuary. And now, let us discuss about the western region. 40 mammal species and 450 bird species are available, and the good topography and climate, and 300 Asiatic lions at Gir Forest of Gujarat, and the Dandgadra Sanctuary, Velavadar National Park and Marine National Park in Gulf of Kutch, and particularly the western ecosystem that is popular for the lions in the Gir Forest, and the Sasan Gir National Park, as we have already seen, the Asiatic lions, leopards and Indian cobra, and the hyenas, jackals and mongoose, and Indian palm civets. And therefore, these are some popular animals available in the Sasan Gir National Park, and similarly the Panch National Park in Maharashtra. And again, that we have seen, most of the animals which are available in the western ecosystem, they are available here. And here some other animals, Chausinga, flying squirrel and langur. So, these are some different varieties which you can see only in the western ecosystem. And now, what are the values of the forest ecosystem? Commercial value, because that we are sustaining the economy, recreational, biological, aesthetic, because they are giving some aesthetic value also, and scientific value and social value. And therefore, these are all some values that which the forests are providing. And now, what can be done? The type and number of wildlife differs with the type and age of the trees, the natural forest openings, the types of vegetation on the forest floor, the presence of natural predators. And the management is geared towards the increase of number of desired species of wildlife. And if desired populations are present, the goal is to maintain those populations. Buffer conservation zones centered around areas of particular endemism, and other areas can be designated for limited sustainable commercial activities. So, these are all the things that we have to do for maintaining the forest management. And now, the summary. In this episode, the types of forest and forest coverage, the issues of sustainable management of forest, the main issues of forest management, some important forest in north, east, west and south India, and some steps to be taken for the better forest management have been discussed in detail. Now, let us have some questions. The first question, mention the various types of forest. The second question, write three main issues of forest management. And third, write the important steps in preserving the biodiversity. And the fourth one, write two major forests of north, east, west and south India each. And the last question, mention some values of forest. And with that, let us conclude this episode. Have a nice time. Thank you.